So Felicia's always been really generous with her research, and she's always been really generous with her knowledge. And tonight, I'm hoping that we're going to be able to repay her for her generosity.
That's my cue. What we do, you see that net there? That net is 20 years old. It can only be purchased from one location in England. And the state of South Carolina will not let them buy it. So, what we're going to do tonight is after Felicia's done talking, we want you to stay for about 15 more minutes because we're going to run a very short fundraiser and try to buy her a net. So, please stick around. We'll go into more details. Show the next slide if you would. We'll go into more details and maybe send her off with a bang. So, with your help, we want to show them that these folks, the people who believe in the Red Knots, believe in Seabrook Island, Kiowa, the islands here, Giant's Island, are supportive of this program, and I think we can help them out. So, please stick around.
So I should know this by heart. A couple times we've done this, but Felicia has her master's in biology from Clemson. She's been doing this, I believe, for 30 years, and she joined SCDNR in 2001, and now leads the South Carolina Seabird and Shorebird projects. Her primary tasks are promoting conservation of important sites. That's really important. DeVoe and all these islands that are around here. And she surveys seabirds, shorebirds. She partners with universities. We've all heard the Wimble stories and all. And then she's co-author on numerous scientific publications. In 2020, she was awarded the Biologist of the Year by the Southeastern Association of Fish and Wildlife Agencies. Felicia.
Well, I'm just floored at what Mark said and potential of having a new net. Wow. I have to say our net's pretty dry rotted and a small group in England makes it. And you can imagine a state government trying to buy a net from a birding club in England was impossible. So I don't know, the possibility of that would be just wonderful. And again, thank you for being here. I just also can't believe so many people are spending their Thursday night to listen and learn about Red Knots, that your presence gives me hope. Okay. Well, I have three wonderful women that I work with. I just want to recognize them. Mary Catherine, Janet, and Cami's here. So just all of this wouldn't be possible without my colleagues and friends. So this shorebird lineup is most of the shorebirds you would see in South Carolina. I saw Caitlin in the back. She put this together, and it's become popular on websites and Facebook pages. And about in the middle, in terms of size, is our red knot. It's a pretty chunky bird with short legs, and it gets its name red knot from its bright rufous colors that appear in the breeding season, which here is spring right before they go to the Arctic. So two-thirds of our shorebirds in North America nest in boreal and Arctic habitat, and red knots are one of those that nest in the high latitudes of the Arctic. So hard to believe that those birds on the beach today, this week, are going to head to the Arctic late May. And because the Arctic is pretty harsh, I have never been this high latitude where they nest. They only disappear and go to the Arctic for about a month, month and a half, 2 months. And really amazing, the females right after the eggs lay, they leave the Arctic because it's so harsh and head south. And then the males, about 3 weeks later, once the chicks fledge, they head south. So I was lucky enough to go to James Bay, which is a boreal Arctic habitat, which is sort of their next stop. When they leave the Arctic, they stop there before coming to temperate areas. And I saw waves of adults, and then a couple weeks later, waves of juveniles. So the young fly south, not following the adults, but the migration pattern's just innate. So parents leave the Arctic, protecting themselves from that harsh condition, and then leave all their young up there to go south later on their own. So they're only up in the Arctic nesting a short while. They spend most of their life, most of the annual cycle, most of the year in the wintering area. And the Rufa red knot, that's the subspecies that we have on the Atlantic coast. It has four wintering areas, the very tip of South America, the north coast of South America, and then the southeast right here and the Bahamas. And then just a few also spend the winter on the western Gulf Coast in Central America. So the ones that are wintering on the very tip of South America, they're flying almost 20,000 miles every single year. So one bird that was observed in Argentina for 13 years, we know that it flew the distance from the Earth to the Moon. And actually, it was seen again for 21 years total. So it really flew to the distance of to the Moon and back. So just really, we call these long distance migrant birds, and they truly are. And then during this migration, they have really important places they stop. So they don't just fly from the tip of South America to the Arctic in one go. They stop and they rest and they fatten up for the next leg of their journey. And the most important stop on the Atlantic coast is Delaware Bay in the spring. So this whole pattern of stopping areas has been kind of likened to a ladder, and the stopovers are like rungs of a ladder. And if one of them disappears, then the whole process can't happen. So the Rufa red knot is federally threatened, and in Canada, it is endangered. That's where it nests in Canada. And this has been brought about by declines witnessed in the wintering population in South America, which have declined by about 75% in the last decades. And also at that big important stopover area in Delaware Bay, which they have declined by 70% in the last couple decades. And as you can imagine, a bird that's flying all the way across the hemisphere, or at least halfway across the hemisphere, it's also just, it's the many threats can affect its migration and its survival. So you could have an oil spill off the coast of Argentina or an oil spill off South America. They're going to stop at both places. There's also predators in the Arctic, predators here. And then, of course, just weather. Climate change caused events, but also just hurricanes and storms that can affect them. One of the main reasons that we think red knots have declined, thus been listed as threatened, is from reduced food at that really important staging area in Delaware Bay. So horseshoe crabs come up to the beaches and lay millions of eggs. And the birds have evolved to stop in Delaware Bay and maybe other beaches to eat these eggs that fuel their northern migration to the Arctic. And research has shown that the harvest of these horseshoe crabs, thus the decline of their food, has led to lower weight of red knots in Delaware Bay and lower survival rates and less breeding success. But back to South Carolina, we are starting to really understand the importance of South Carolina for red knots. So only kind of recently have we been doing research and put our beaches on the map as well for an important staging or stopover area. So recent research has shown that up to 17,000 knots are stopping in the spring at Seabrook and Kiowa. And a lot of this research was done by people in this room. So grateful for people that looked for color banded birds. That's how we got our estimate for how many birds stop here. And like Mark said, there'll be hundreds and later on thousands of red knots on the beaches here. So this 17,000 is about 27% of the estimated total population. So that really makes these beaches important for red knots. And they're staying probably over a month. And also through the resighting of color bands, we know that all four wintering populations are moving through these beaches. And, you know, why wouldn't South Carolina be important? We have clams on the beach. They're eating donax, or also known as coquinas right now. In the swash zone, you'll see red knots moving back and forth in the shallow water and eating these really beautiful, colorful clams. And then when the water warms, we also in South Carolina have horseshoe crabs spawning. And on the right is a cluster of horseshoe crab eggs. So these birds in South Carolina, you can observe them feeding on these clusters of eggs. They're really fatty, protein-rich food source. And this video was taken in 2019 by Fletcher Smith, who's spoken to this group, so some of you know. It was on an island in the south coast of South Carolina, and all these knots are feeding on horseshoe crab eggs and the gulls and many other shorebirds, making use of this food resource in South Carolina. I know, it's just amazing. Like one of the, you know, most amazing things I've ever seen in my life, to see this kind of gathering of shorebirds. Oops. And so at these spring stopover sites, so they're stopping and they're feeding before they make the trip to the Arctic to nest in the spring. They're doubling their weight. They're putting on a lot of fat to fuel that flight to the Arctic. So on the left is a bird that probably just arrived in South Carolina or even spent the winter there, very thin. And then on the right, you can see they kind of look like butterball turkeys when they're about to leave late May. I mean, they're just bulging with fat. Like you can hardly see their legs, just the belly is hanging over. And they're also building up pectoral muscles to fly and just putting on that fuel to make the trip. Also, when you think about it, they're headed to the Arctic where it could be pretty snowy. So they also have to have extra fat and fuel to maybe make a couple days mating, finding a mate without feeding because it could be snow covered. And also at this spring stopover site, it's really important because this is the time they put on that breeding plumage. So they molt from that gray color on the left to the beautiful rufous breeding plumage. And these bright red, any kind of breeding plumage that's brilliant is actually more energy expensive than making the dull gray feathers. So they really need a place with a lot of food and places to rest during this spring stopover. So also, as Mark said, a lot of people help participate by doing ground counts. The last year, Cammie's also here. She was up in the airplane. So South Carolina DNR, Janet and Cammie were in a DNR law enforcement plane taking photos of red knot flocks. And then Georgia DNR Fletcher Smith was in a small plane taking pictures of flocks in kind of a one-day snapshot of how many birds red knots are using Georgia and South Carolina in the spring. So where are the red knots? Right there, right there. So Janet used a computer program where she actually just has to take the mouse and put a dot on every bird, but you don't have to count the dots. The computer program tallies them, but it still took her a long time to do all the photos for the coast. But amazingly, the May 8th count of Georgia and South Carolina came up to over 13,000 red knots, and the April one over 10,000. So it wasn't even all of South Carolina, and you know, maybe that's a low estimate. But the Fish and Wildlife Service estimate for the total population is 63,000. So that's 15 to 20% of all of roofer red knots are at one time on the beaches in South Carolina and Georgia. So again, just our area is very important for the survival of this species. Oops. All right. So we put on some geolocators on red knots about 10 years ago. It wasn't the most fruitful project because you have to recapture the individual, take off the little tag that's on the back of their band. So very difficult to catch a bird and then to catch it twice. But we did get a few off. And I got this migration map from one of them. This bird we caught eating horseshoe crab eggs at DeVoe Bank. It went directly from South Carolina to James Bay, then up to the Arctic, then all the way down to Tierra del Fuego for the winter, and then back to South Carolina. So this was kind of the first hint that not only do we have a lot of red knots in South Carolina, but maybe some of them are not going through Delaware Bay. They're just flying directly from South Carolina to the Arctic, which makes our beaches even more important because this could also be a place where they're doing one of these spring staging or stopover areas. So here comes the net. So for the last 10 years, every year we've been catching some red knots with this 20-year-old net now. Very exciting, important work. We pick a day with low tide at dawn and put the net out. And then as the tide rises mid-morning, we launch the net over the birds as they are pushed with the tide in front of the net. And with a lot of volunteers and help, we quickly process each bird. We take measurements, especially the weight, because we're really interested if there's enough food in South Carolina to allow these birds to get really fat and ready for that trip to the Arctic. And we also put on individually marked flags or bands on the legs. And because these birds fly across the whole hemisphere, each country is assigned a color. So all of the migratory, long-distance migratory shorebirds that are banded in the United States get a green flag or band on their leg. And then one reason we know that we have birds that winter in the tip of South America in South Carolina is because we've seen birds with orange and red bands on their legs. So the red one top left, I took a picture of it in Cape Romaine National Wildlife Refuge. And then the one with the orange band, we actually caught it in the net in a couple years ago at Seabrook. So that one was banded by a woman in Argentina. I actually met her at a meeting. So I sent her the photo via email. That was super fun. And, you know, said, we got your bird. And, you know, it's also connected me with other people in the hemisphere. So we're also, to answer some of these questions on how important South Carolina is, we've been deploying these nano tags. And like the word says, they're really small tags. We're just clipping a few feathers and super gluing them on. And they're so small, you could put them on large insects like butterflies, on bats, and really small birds. There's a system of towers all across the North America and now moving into South America. These towers are picking up the signal that these nano tags are sending out. So it's a real collaborative network of towers. And as you probably know, a lot of communities, maybe even your community has a tower that is working collaboratively to understand migration of all these animals. So we put on some tags this past year at Kiowa 40, and we also put on these tags 2017 and 19. And a few of them were put on in Florida. So this is the array of migration paths that all those birds took. So you can see it's pretty diverse, actually. Oops, very sensitive. Okay, so on the right is kind of a static picture of all the migration paths that were just animated in the previous slide. So all the orange ones did not go through Delaware Bay. So each line is an individual red knot's path going north. And all the white dots are towers, so they're not a stopover. So basically, most of the red knots leaving South Carolina or probably the Southeast are not stopping in Delaware Bay. And they're going directly to James Bay without stopping. So that was a real important discovery, because that makes our area one of the really important staging areas for spring migration. And just interestingly, when we looked at all of the timing and flights of those over 100 red knots, 80% of them were using tailwinds to go north. So we define a tailwind as any wind in the direction of flight within 90 degrees. So that means they're probably timing when they leave to go north when there's a wind at their back. So they're kind of waiting for those winds coming from the south and then taking off. And that's probably how a lot of migration paths in the world for birds have evolved, is making use of seasonal weather wind changes. So really exciting. This past year, we got a hold of a couple solar satellite tags. And I think we're the only, Delaware Bay and us are the, in South Carolina, the only two projects that have used these on red knots. It's really new technology. They only weigh 2 grams, but they're a lot bigger than a nano tag because they're communicating with the satellites. And so it has to be big enough to have a big enough solar panel to power all that communication with the satellite. So they're surprisingly light. When I got them, I was just, they almost feel like a feather, but they're pretty big. And so we put on 3 at Kiowa last early May, and just amazed at the results. So we're able to look at their movement while they're in South Carolina before they leave for the Arctic. And if you recognize some of these places, there's Seabrook and DeVoe and Kiowa. So we tagged them on Kiowa, and those were some of the locations before this bird flew to the Arctic. And already I've discovered a lot of neat things. Like this bird went to kind of near Morris Island, and I thought, what? I've never seen knots there. Why would it go there? And I just happened to be there mid-June, and I saw all these horseshoe crabs upside down. So I thought, wow, a spawning site I didn't know about, place I didn't know red knots went. Also, there's been very few red knot nests found ever. There's only a handful of records and information about red knot nesting, because it's just such hard to get to places. So immediately I was connected with the Canadian Wildlife Service, and I gave them access to where these birds were nesting. So as you can see, they're each 3 is diagrammed in a different color. It's route north and then also back to the southeast. And you can see that they nested in, let's just try the pointer real quick. They nested in pretty different areas, up here, there, and then this was another nesting area. So the Canadian Wildlife Service biologists actually tried to get to one of these nesting sites to just see a red knot nest, and the weather would not allow them to get there. But, you know, excited to stay in touch with them next year, and hopefully somebody can get to the nest and just learn more about their nesting biology. So this is the kind of thing that we can view on our computers. I usually all summer woke up every morning and just would see where the bird is. So this animation is one bird's track. We banded in South Carolina at Kiowa, then it went up to James Bay, then up to the Arctic to nest, and then came back to South Carolina. And because we just glued on these tags, I think it just probably fell off. So it's still amazing. It fell off in October, and you know, it stayed on like half a year. And so we're on the right is kind of a zoomed in area of its nesting site. So we're actually getting up to 10 locations every day. But on the left, you know, we're just picking out a few of the real accurate locations. So from this, you can really probably see that its nest was right in the middle of where it was moving over the course of July and just into early August. So we can give this to Canadian Arctic researchers and say, there's a nesting pair right there. So this one was really interesting. So again, this is the track one of the birds with the satellite tag took. It headed up. Again, I remember looking on my computer. I think I was even talking to Mark. And it was headed to the Arctic directly from South Carolina, probably going to go to James Bay, not stop anywhere. And then it turned around and went to Delaware Bay. It was phenomenal. Why would it go south when it was, you know, it was May 24th and it should be just headed to James Bay and on to the Arctic? And I looked up the band. It had a band when we caught it, and it was banded in New Jersey in 2017 and had been seen in New Jersey in Delaware Bay. And also this past year, they had great horseshoe crab spawning. So there was food there. So we took a look at the weather that you can go on to NOAA's website and look at archived weather. And there was a big front right where it turned around on May 24th. So this is the weather on May 24th last year. So it was a front. It was dropping temperature, cold front. It was, you know, headwinds and precipitation, which could have been sleet and snow. And the weather actually just shot it right to Delaware Bay. So this was really amazing. Amazing find. A lot of people in the shorebird world were just amazed that not only are these birds taking a diverse amount of routes, you know, some going up the Atlantic coast, some from South Carolina directly to James Bay, but maybe each, even individual knots are making decisions as they fly where their next stop will be. And I was just curious, you know, remember all the smoke last year? Maybe it wasn't just the wind, maybe it was smoke, but the bird had actually passed the it was labeled as medium smoke on May 24th when it turned around. It seemed like it had just passed through a lot of smoke and was kind of in the clear when it turned around. So I suspect it was that cold front, but you never know, maybe the smoke made it weak and a cold front, it just decided to head to Delaware Bay and eat some horseshoe crab eggs for a week and then try again. So it did go, you know, a week at Delaware Bay, then it headed to the Arctic, and we think it successfully nested. So, well, you know, as Mark was mentioning, and the real reason we do all this is because we hope that our findings can make a difference. And I'm just amazed at all the progress on Seabrook, on Kiowa, and really all the beaches in South Carolina. Like 10 years ago, nobody knew what a knot was. And now I go out there and people come up to me and say, stay away from the knots, don't bother them. And I'm like, that's great. I'm so glad I'm just so glad you know about them. So, you know, there's signs on the beaches, 40 some stewards are signing up. And just really seeing that our research is making a difference, because we realize that this place is really actually critical for the survival of the species. And a lot of people, not me, it's people in this room organized the Sea Island Shorebird Festival, which also was just amazing testament to how much people care about red knots and you know, and the diversity of people that care about it. It was a wonderful festival with a lot of outreach, field trips, really all centered on trying to educate people about red knots and appreciate them. And I also think this research has fed into conservation of their prey items that they use in South Carolina. So prey being their food. And so our research and surveys have fed into the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service critical habitat designation. Fancy words, fancy plans, but basically the federal agency, the Federal Wildlife Agency, U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, they have designated certain places as really important in the species range for their survival. And so they've designated 30 beaches as critical habitat in South Carolina. And last year it was decided that horseshoe crabs can't be harvested in this designated critical habitat so that the red knots could feed on the eggs. So just great to see that research and all our efforts are equaling hopefully some positive change for shorebirds. And then also just knowledge of what they eat and when they eat is guiding renourishment projects. And all of this is not stopping horseshoe crab harvest or stopping renourishment projects. It's just guiding when they would be better to occur. So I have to comment on renourishment projects. And, you know, we suggest they don't occur while red knots are fattening up in May for their flight to the Arctic, because South Carolina is really critical for their survival. So, well, so many people to thank, including probably everybody in this room, because they came here tonight, that made all this possible. Just multiple people, agencies, and just tons of volunteers. Grateful for everybody that's contributed. And the last thing I wanted to say is, like, what's next? So Caitlin, DNR, she's in the back of the room. She took this last year at Marsh Island in Cape Vermilion National Wildlife Refuge where there wasn't harvest and all these shorebirds are eating horseshoe crab eggs. So what is next is we, through just all the successes, have 14 satellite tags to put on this spring. So we'll be reaching out to everybody if they can help us manage beaches, help band. So we'll be putting on 14 tags. And our Marine Division of South Carolina DNR is going to contact me, you know, maybe every morning, find out where some of our tag birds are going, and then just go and see what they're eating. They're invertebrate specialists. So we're going to be able to really use the satellite tag data to understand why the birds move around while they're in the Southeast. Are they following the food? And if so, it helps us understand how important that is. And there's another festival this year coming up in March. So look out for announcements on that. And thank you very much.
Hey, Sean, we'll take some questions. If anybody would like to ask Felicia some questions, we have one over here.
The horseshoe crab, how did the medical research? Are there other reasons?
No, that's the only reason they can be harvested in South Carolina, and that's the law. They aren't harvested for any other reason.
In New Jersey, they were harvested to provide bait for catching conch. Makes sense. Like a breeding population using bait.
Is there explain this lab here before the shorebird. I forgot the details. Can you explain briefly what it is about knots? It has something to do with the mortality or birth rate that you can tag a bird and have a pretty reliable marker on the
Probably not. Can I just run through that again? I'm afraid I don't know. I mean, I would kind of guess that it is similar concept with a lot of species that you only have to tag a small amount, you know, like 4%. And with a lot of resighting surveys, you can get sort of your ability to see the banded birds, you get that error rate. So not only are you seeing, let's say, you know, you see a bird ABC for a couple weeks and you know, wow, it was on our beach for 2 weeks, but then you see it again in like 3 weeks, then you can also calculate an error rate to your being able to observe it. And so that ability to calculate, you know, your error rate allows you just to band a small amount and still get a population estimate, and then also how long they're on your beach. But I'm sure I did not explain it as well as Fletcher. Okay.
Do you explain birds and away from either here or Delaware Bay, all the way to James Bay, turning off their brain and flying at night?
I don't know the answer to that either. Yeah, anybody know the answer? I mean, of course I've read about it, but I don't know the mechanics of it. It's incredible.
If you track these birds that she's done, you find that they're flying at about 60 miles an
hour. I think they turn half their brain off and keep going.
Yeah, that was kind of new.
That other, yeah.
Amazing. I know dolphins do that as well. So maybe as we research more animals, maybe I wish I could do it. No. And they're not prohibiting it in South Carolina either, just in South Carolina on designated red knot critical habitat. Last year we tagged 80. We put 40 nano tags out, 3 satellite tags, and then just some had flags. And seems like a lot of people know Fletcher Smith. He's going to do his master's research on resighting and looking at red knots. So he's kind of guiding how many we need to tag. And that was his suggested amount, like around 80 a year. Yeah, there are research projects that have shown that tags, you know, stop birds from successfully breeding. And I think that image where you saw the birds were staying in one place shows to me that it nested. I mean, we don't know if it's successful, but probably, because if they're not successful, they only have energy to lay one clutch of eggs. And if like an Arctic fox eats it, they leave. So to me, that says they were successful. And I also showed this to researchers that work on shorebirds, you know, for their entire career. And they said, that looks like nesting to me. So I think it's definitely something to always start out slow. You know, we only put 3 tags on and it looks like all 3 nested. But if they had not, then I would probably not do it again. Great question. Yeah. Oh, what are they eating? Oh, yes. So I probably keep saying horseshoe crabs. They're eating the eggs. Yes. No, I probably just so used to saying horseshoe crabs and meant eggs. I know they eat a variety of invertebrates. I mean, really try to look up the nesting literature on red knot nesting. There's not much, but I have been up to Churchill, which is the Arctic habitat, and as the snow melts, there's wetlands everywhere, and every single pond is just teeming with, you know, wiggly things, invertebrates, and there are mosquitoes, and even if you just sit on the ground, there are insects just crawling all over you. It's just so many insects and invertebrates that I think that's probably why most of these shorebirds fly to the Arctic to nest. 24 hours of light, just incredible wetland that's melted and full of food. And there are also very few predators. We monitor shorebirds in South Carolina, and as you know, there's just so many predators, crows and bobcats and foxes and coyotes and jays. And then in the Arctic, you really only have a few predators. So it's worth that flight up there because it's full of food and light and few predators.
What is the predator?
You know, I don't know if I could even pick a primary one. For our seabird colonies, I would probably say raccoons and mink, but the shorebirds like the oyster catchers, willets, Wilson's plover, they nest kind of hidden by themselves. So it's really a variety of things.
Oh, wasn't that fantastic?